This is March 2013. We decide to hang in on the department and build these batteries, and build this battery management system, build the chargers, and build a mock scooter to demo all of it. So hum to project college project ki tarah we keep building it. People love the idea of the scooter that we are showing these batteries on. They don't want to buy batteries from us. They want to buy a good product from us. I think you'll very quickly realize that most deep tech or hardware businesses have a better revenue to capital raise ratio
than
almost most consumer businesses. Their problem is not capital. I think internet businesses suck up a lot more capital into things which are not even asset creating, like advertising or discounting. A product business, especially a physical product business, you will not have traction till pretty much the end of the journey. So that is a real problem. And it really makes a lot of investors very nervous.
2035, 10 years out, without getting to numbers, what would you want Ather to stand for?
I think Madras had a very special thing going then. And I think it should be studied more. I think it's worth investing a lot to recreate it. But it's not natural. It won't recreate automatically just by starting an incubation cell. I would say there are a few things that really went in favor of IIT Madras at that point. First, this is 2007 when we went to college, first year. That was the year when a bunch of alumni got together to inaugurate this thing called CFI, Center for Innovation. I think it was a massive lab, like, I don't know, like 40, 50, 60,000 square feet. They took one of the massive workshops, which was empty, and they donated to students, and they like stuffed it with a whole bunch of equipments, right? So you've got CNC machines, you've got every form of thing that you would need for prototyping, a whole bunch of even raw material, everything just there. And I realized it much later that what it kick-started in our batch onwards was something that hadn't happened before. Because it started becoming common for people to just hang out in CFI over the weekends and often late in the evenings, building their thing. Without like, you know, it being a resume point or without
prompt,
koi academic prompt nahi hai, koi extracurricular prompt nahi hai. Like there was a giant number of people working on drones, gliders, FSA teams started because of CFI, people building race cars. In fact, so Swapnil was one of the founding team members of Raftar, the race car team at campus, because of CFI. And it became just culturally acceptable that, yeah, what are you doing over the weekend? Yeah, I'm in CFI, I'm building this thing. Or I'm building these robots that trace lines and, you know, will win some competition somewhere. I'm just learning. It just started, I think, a culture of that being so common that when I looked at our seniors who couldn't understand it, I think it hit me much later that this is not common. This was not common before. So CFI started in 2007. The Entrepreneurship Club was active, but I'm not sure if I would say that was the primary reason, honestly. But then the research park happened in 2009, I believe. This was a bunch of other directors taking inspiration from the Stanford something.
That's right.
Yeah. And they started the research park. And other two things also, I would say, happened. Professor Junjunwala, who had been trying to do in like startups at scale, like literally a factory of startups for like at least 10, 20 years before that. And I would give a small amount of credit also to our department, engineering design. Case in point, we were the third batch. We had 22 people or 24 people in our class. I was last doing a census, at least 2/3 of our department attempted to do a startup at some point.
That's amazing.
Of our class.
Yeah.
And I've heard over the years that there are just a higher number of people from this department who've attempted to start up over the years. Because I think it created the right set of situations. So I started making weekend Bangalore trips where Swapnil was. I was in Chennai. I'd go to weekends, spend the weekend with him. Slyly pitching him. Trying to brainwash him ki wapas aa ja kuch karta hai, he was dying to anyways. So aisa nahi wo fight maani padi, teen char trip mare, third trip tak to wo convince ho gaya tha. So I told him finally kaam karta hai, another thing was happening. So I was making these trips on parallel. Every weekend I was not there, I was in ID, so I would just come back to the campus on Friday evenings after finishing work. There was a colleague, there was a friend from my batch who was still doing his research there. So he would let me in the department and I would go crash in the department. So department everybody knew. Tarun ka yahan pe ek yoga mat aur ek pillow pada hai. Theek hai, wo aata hai, wahan pe sota hai. Theek hai. Professors also turned a blind eye. They were very nice to us.
Yeah.
Okay. So I'd come on Friday night. I'd go crash there. And I'd use the time to basically, in my isolation, read. I just wanted to read everything about electric vehicles. And gradually I started building some of these battery packs as because swappable battery pack pe patent file kiya hai, toh let's try building these batteries. Kya hota hai? And car to bana nahi sakte, toh scooter bana ke dekhte hai. So 6 months in, I built a bunch of these batteries. I have read a lot about electric vehicles. And I've become a bit comfortable with the idea of building at least battery packs. So I pitched to Swapnil ki yaar, what if these electric scooters are going to cross the border and come to India from China, ye swappable battery pack banayenge, then it could solve a lot of problems that consumers have.
Yeah.
So maybe we should start a business building swappable battery packs and running a swapping network for the upcoming wave of electrification.
Which is Battery Smart, which we funded 8 years later.
Yeah. So I wrote this pitch, told it to him. He sold. I come back. He calls me and says on Monday, ki maine resign kar diya, and they've let me go. I'll be in Chennai by the next weekend. I'm like, I have still not left my job. Main to aise hi bola tha teko. Main socha ki ek saal baad chodenge, 6 mahine baad chodenge. To isne resign kar diya. Ye to boriya avastha ban ke aa raha hai Chennai.
You sell well, obviously.
Huh?
You sell vision well, obviously.
Or he really wanted to leave. Okay, whatever.
One of the two.
One of the two. So now it starts a panic in my head. Achha, mujhe bhi chhod dena chahiye. Around that time, they give me the probation letter, which means my probation's ended and please sign here to become a full-time employee. I feel really bad. I'm like, I know deep down I don't want to work. I will not work here. It's a nice company. It's trying to be fair to me. It's offering me full-time employment.
Hmm.
So bad if I sign this now. I shouldn't sign this. So I get the letter and I run away from the office immediately. I get the letter at 9:30. 12 o'clock, I'm back in campus, IIT Madras, middle of a weekday. And Swapnil had already come back to campus. We both go meet a professor. And we pitched to him, ki, listen, we really want to leave our jobs. We don't want to do this. We instead want to build batteries for electric vehicles. The professor is very kind. He's like, don't worry. You just need some blessing, right? I'm telling you, leave your jobs. I'll find a way to support you guys. Subsistence. Okay. But leave the jobs. Okay. The department will support our students. Very good. So I also leave. Okay. Next month, both of us are now sitting in the department. But we haven't started up yet.
Mm.
Because at this point, the idea that this is startup is still not clear to us.
Yeah.
What we do know is that electric vehicles are coming. And unka problem battery mein aur charging mein hai. So we should do something to solve the problem. So we are fundamentally builders and problem solvers. Will this be a startup? We honestly don't know still. So we don't start up. What we instead do, this is March 2013. We decide to hang around the department and build these batteries. And build this battery management system. Build the chargers and build a mock scooter to demo all of it. So hum to project college project ki tarah we keep building it. We spend the entire year doing this.
Okay.
We haven't started up Ather yet.
Okay.
Okay. There is no official entity called Ather. There is no funding. There is no investor. There is no angel. There are no founders also.
Correct.
There are just two people building under the name Ather Energy.
Okay.
Okay. We build karte karte through the course of 2013 and we kept meeting people pitching this idea. We realized ki yaar, people love the idea of the scooter that we are showing these batteries on. They don't want to buy batteries from us. They want to buy a good product from us. Battery is not a product they care about. So maybe the problem is the scooter and not the battery. And Swapnil really embraces this idea. He really believes ki yaar, banana to pura product chahiye. We shouldn't stall ourselves by just building a midway solution. Technical solution nahi banate, pura product banate. So it was actually a leap for me. Because I was a bit worried ki pura scooter kaise banaye.
Yeah, it's like you're moving full stack from a small piece of the puzzle.
Yeah. But his confidence was very high. So we took that leap and we started pitching the scooter.
To whom? Sorry?
Just anybody.
Just the idea.
We just pitched to anybody, by the way, at this point. Okay. Apart from Tiger, who all credit to Lee back in the day.
Yeah, Lee was crazy enough.
Lee was crazy, took this bet.
Yeah.
But there's not a single VC on a cap table.
There you go. And he's not Indian by any means. he's as Manhattan as they come.
So I think the problem is metrics. And I don't think the challenge is capital as much as it is gestation.
Yeah.
Let me explain both.
Yeah.
It is certainly not a capital problem, because take the few hardware companies that have become now large or gone public and compare their revenue generated to capital deployed. I think you'll very quickly realize that most deep tech or hardware businesses have a better revenue to capital raise ratio
than even consumers.
Then almost most consumer businesses, including the ones who, which are really successful, are most established metrics. Yeah.
That's a fascinating stat in itself. We should do some math around that and show
it
that.
It is worth, what, about $2.5 billion today?
Yeah, 21,000 crores, I checked.
Yes, yeah. Roughly that much, yeah. We would have raised, including the IPO, maybe 6,000-7,000 crores.
And pre-IPO?
Like 700-800 million. Sami lakhe bol raha hu.
Nahin, pre-IPO kitna tha? Sorry.
Valuation?
No, capital raised.
I think we raised 3,000 crores and IPO mein 2,600 crores. So 6,000 roughly.
6,000 give or take.
So about 800 million. So 800 million went in to create a $2.5 billion car today outcome. And I think it'll obviously hopefully compound. And I think you will see similar ratios, even better ratios for many other players. Their problem is not capital. I think internet businesses suck up a lot more capital into things which are not even asset creating.
Yeah.
Like advertising or discounting.
Yeah.
A lot of the deep tech or hardware businesses actually create fundamental IP or real assets behind it.
Correct.
Like if a factory mein 1,000 crore ja raha hai, then there's a real asset being created of 1,000 crore.
That's right.
Yeah.
That's right.
It is, however, gestation. That which also brings me to this, the, my first point that I said. The problem really is from an investor's perspective, metrics. When they are, when things take a long time, you really don't have enough metrics to rub around to have a new conversation every year, which is roughly time you need to fundraise.
Yeah.
Every year you need to fundraise, right? So every fundraise, you need a new story. But for things that take 5 years to build, how do you cook up a story every year, right? Like, yeah, we are 20% of the way to building the product. Why don't you give us more money, right? It's very hard.
Yeah. Too many VCs who take that.
Right? Internet-enabled businesses, you put in X rupees, you will get some Y outcome, right?
Yeah.
Kuch customer aayega, app download aayega, kuch
yeah.
purchase hoga.
Some GMV is there.
Some form of GMV or consumer traction is there.
Yeah.
But a product business, especially a physical product business, you will not have traction till pretty much the end of the journey.
Yeah.
So that is a real problem. And it really makes a lot of investors very nervous, because investors are, let's be honest, if you have the option of choosing an established metric, if high quick commerce, mein, these are the metrics on which your next round is made or broken.
Correct.
You can at least have an objective conversation. I think given the fact that the entire powertrain is electric, you are already starting off on a distinct advantage where you can build a lot of features which are fundamentally electronic or electrical in nature.
Correct.
That ICE can't recreate. Let me offer a few examples. Cruise control is a feature that if you ever wanted to build on an ICE, will require you to put hardware worth 4,000-5,000 rupees, 6,000 rupees on the ICE powertrain. That's my rough assessment. On an electric, cruise control is a zero cost implementation. In our case, 100 rupees because we wanted one extra sensor for safety. That's it. Heel hold, a feature that cars have, two-wheelers cannot have because it requires electrical brakes. And electrical brakes will cost you like another 5,000-6,000 rupees, right? On an EV, heel hold is a zero cost implementation.
Wow.
Okay. If you want to do, like the amount of features that we can open up with an electrical powertrain and really, really, really smart software on it is an order of magnitude higher than what ICE vehicles can ever do at that cost structure. Actually, they can't. Which is why, at least in the scooter world, I believe upgrade is not synonymous with electric. Like all the feature sets, you want cruise control, you want heel hold, you want brakeless experience where the vehicle automatically will slow down, you want the beautiful touchscreen dashboard, you want, like we build this helmet.
Yeah.
Yeah. And then this helmet, now you can just tell the helmet, hey, I want to go here and it'll start navigation there. You can just tell the helmet, actually the helmet will tell you that, hey, I've detected it's raining. I'm turning on rain traction control for you. And it can turn rain traction control on the vehicle for you.
Amazing.
You can't do it with a nice architecture.
Tempted to get an Ather.
Yeah. So my point is that there are many things like these which because of the electrical powertrain, you can now unlock his experiences, which are very difficult to do with ICE. And I have now become a believer that that's the real opportunity.
That's a wrap on this weekday episode of the Blume podcast. We've handpicked these moments to give you the most valuable insights in the least amount of time.
Our season partner UltraHuman is back for a second time. I'm biased as the seed investor here, but their immensely loved brand is making waves globally. UltraHuman is a health tech pioneer redefining how we track and improve our health. Their sleek titanium ring air and its new rare metal cousins accurately track sleep, movement, and recovery to deliver real-time health insights and personalized nudges. UltraHuman is creating a unique health ecosystem built on top of the wearable data. It just launched Blood Vision in the US in addition to India, a blood testing service that offers a panel of over 100 longevity and chronic disease biomarkers with the convenience of an at-home test. They're also launching UltraHuman Home globally for environment-aware analysis and sleep insights. Whatever your health fix, go sign up and experience being truly UltraHuman. Our season partner, IDFC First Bank, has earned its reputation as one of India's most startup-friendly banks through its First Wings program, which provides dedicated mentorship and tailored financial solutions to help early-stage ventures scale effectively. Coincidentally, many of Blume's portfolio companies, much later stage, also partner with IDFC First Bank for their banking and financial needs. If you're well-funded and scaling, they're a great lending and banking partners, and our portfolio companies would attest to that.